the special counsel confirmed that the Russian government sponsored efforts to illegally interfere with the 2016 presidential election, but did not find that the Trump campaign or other Americans colluded in those efforts.
I'm having a good day, too. It was called No Collusion, No Obstruction. There never was, by the way, and there never will be.
Freedom is back in style. Welcome to the revolution.
Yeah, we're coming to your city. Gonna play our guitars and sing you a country song.
New Sean Hannity Show. More behind-the-scenes information on breaking news and more bold, inspired solutions for America.
What do you think is the story that's been uncovered in the past 2 years?
That the entire Russia collusion narrative was made up, that the FBI and the intelligence community and the Department of Justice began an investigation against four American citizens simply because they worked for the opposition political candidate, that being Donald Trump. She is taking the FBI to task for having given unlimited, unsupervised access to raw intelligence. What do you look at in Google? Telephone information, calls, texts, you name it. Everything, every nightmare anybody has of information being collected by Big Brother. The FBI gave three private contractors unlimited, unsupervised access to that.
All right, that was Sidney Powell on a radio show in New York and also on Cheryl Atkinson's. She has her Sunday show called Full Measure. Sidney Powell is the author of the number one runaway bestseller, License to Lie, as you just heard. And it exposes corruption in the Department of Justice. And also senior policy advisor for America First, Peter Schweitzer, joins us. Remember, when he wrote his book, Compromised, and he talked about James Comey, we're going to get into how did Comey's net worth skyrocket so much? What is his connection to Mueller? What do they have with Uranium One? And we welcome you both. Hour two, Sean Hannity Show. Thank you both for being with us. You know, Sidney, I'm listening very closely to what you're saying. I'm going to ask you a two-part question. Where are the FISA judges? When do we ever get to hear from them? Because one thing I've learned in my life about judges, they don't like being lied to. And obviously, a fraud on a spectacular level was perpetrated on them when the bulk of the information presented to them was the Hillary Clinton bought and paid for Russian dossier that they swear when they present it to the judges has been verified. They purposely didn't expose Hillary as having paid for the document, just a slight asterisk. It might have a political taint. What do you think those FISA judges are thinking today?
They should be absolutely outraged, Sean. I mean, if I were one, I would have already had everyone who signed the applications in front of me and under an order to show cause why they shouldn't be held in contempt. But I imagine they are awaiting the report of the Inspector General on the FISA abuses. That's the only reason I can think of that they have been completely silent.
Now, these judges are picked in secret by the Chief Justice. In this case, it would be John Roberts, and they serve varying amounts of time in terms of their term, and there are a number of them, correct?
That's correct.
And so would it be something that they would be able to follow up on if it's discovered, and which it will be, that they were that a fraud was perpetrated on them? In other words, we now know that the bulk of information used in the applications for FISA were based on Hillary's bought and paid for Russian dossier. And the reason it's unverifiable is its author, Christopher Steele, under oath in that interrogatory in Great Britain, says he doesn't even believe his own dossier, has no idea if it's true at all, maybe 50-50, and that it was just raw intelligence. And that's what they signed off on.
I also think Nellie Orr and Glenn Simpson wrote about as much of it as Christopher Steele did, if Christopher Steele actually wrote any of it.
Yeah, well, that's pretty unbelievable. All right, Peter Schweitzer, great to have you back. And your book, Compromised, has done extraordinarily well. And you give a lot of detail about James Comey that we never knew before, like his net worth skyrocketed over 4,000% when he left the DOJ in 2005, returned to the FBI in 2013. He made $6.1 million after Mueller's FBI granted his employer, Lockheed Martin, the largest contract in history. Quote, you call it a billion-dollar boondoggle. I'm not against former law enforcement starting businesses and making money, but the connection to Mueller goes even deeper than that. Why don't you explain?
Yeah, Sean. I mean, I think that's what a lot of people have to realize is that we have to look at institutions like the intelligence community, the way that we look at other government agencies. There's revolving doors. They have incentives to help their friends. In the case of Comey and Mueller, they have a relationship that goes back 25 years, and they've always sort of functioned as a tag team. And so when you have a circumstance where Bob Mueller is put in charge of an investigation that James Comey, his good friend, certainly has a personal interest and stake in, it creates enormous problem. But add on top of that layer, Sean, the fact that, you know, when you look at the Mueller report, the interesting thing that stands out to me, there are a number of things, but part of it is when we look at the subject of foreign interference, the foreign interference that stands out to me is how much of MI6 has fingerprints on this, whether it's Christopher Steele, whether it's some of the stuff that was done to some of the lower level Trump campaign volunteers. It speaks to the problem that when you have an intelligence community, it's a community. And Bob Mueller and James Comey have long, deep established relationships with people in intelligence, which is fine. But when that spills over into interfering in a presidency and a presidential election, you have a huge problem. And that's what I think is the big overlooked story. In addition to all the other headlines that we can glean from the Mueller report.
What you're really saying is, and this now is coming up more and more and more, especially, and we'll have John Solomon coming up at the bottom of the hour, but there is more and more evidence, and I'm hearing a lot more chatter from my sources, that the official start date of this Russia witch hunt was not July 31st. It was not based on Papadopoulos, who was being spied upon and tasked to spy on Papadopoulos and Carter Page and Sam Clovis, that it started well before that, probably in February the same year of 2016, and that some of this might be related to some of our allies and outsourcing of intelligence methods. In other words, using methods that would be illegal for our intelligence officials to use. Again, I want to put this caveat in, though. You know, we have the premier law enforcement agency known as the FBI in the entire world, 99.9%. The same with our intelligence agents. 99.9% would never abuse the powerful tools that we give them. We're talking about that tiny 0.1%, the upper echelon that abused their power here. But did they outsource to foreign countries or task our allies with doing things for them that they knew they couldn't do because it's illegal here? In other words, spy on Americans.
No, I think you're right,
Sean. I'm
pretty
sure the answer to that's yes, but I think your percentage is a little bit high, Sean. I think we've got probably a 20% problem in a lot of the agencies.
Well, that scares me, because if you're talking about the tools of intelligence, that was Chuck Schumer, who probably infamously, famously said that, you know, you screw with the intelligence committee, they're going to get you 10 ways on Sunday.
Right.
Well, I mean, what do you think the percentage is, Peter Schweitzer?
I think it's probably 15 to 20%. I think it's highly concentrated among those that work out of FBI headquarters in Washington, D.C. I mean, you hear this time and time again, people that work at the Bureau, they've done great work in the field. They move to headquarters and it becomes much more political. But I think to your larger point, Sean, you're absolutely right. I mean, this is a story of outsourcing and trying to gin up an investigation without having your fingerprints on it. I mean, you know, look, if you and I lie to the FBI, we all know that that's a crime. If we file a false police report, we claim our neighbor did something nefarious that they didn't do, that's a criminal offense. Well, what essentially...
Unless you're Jesse Smollett.
Right. But, you know, but if you look at what happened in the case of the dossier, the Clintons essentially paid a guy to do that and try to avoid having their fingerprints on it. And I think that's why what the attorney general has said is so important is we need to investigate the investigation. We need to look at the headwaters of all of this and see how did this happen, because it's had a dramatically troubling effect on our politics, on this administration. And if you don't deal with this, this is going to become standard operating procedure in American politics. And I don't think anybody wants that.
So then let me go back to
you. We need to know who the private contractors are that Comey gave that illegal access to the raw FISA, the raw NSA database. That's crucial. One of them's got to be Fusion GPS. There are a lot of indicators for that. One of them may very well be CrowdStrike, the group that also gave the, you know, reviewed the DNC server and is heavily Clinton connected.
Sydney, let me go back to the Mueller report from yesterday. Usually if a prosecutor, or in this case a special counsel, if they can't indict the details of what they may have found, et cetera, it never come out. But that, I think Robert Mueller, because look at the team around him, I think you're the world's biggest critic, and I'm probably number two, of Andrew Weissman, Jeannie Ray, and this merry band of Democratic donors, and only Democratic donors that Mueller surrounded himself with, which was fundamentally unfair in the first place. So we have a definitive statement, no collusion. Got it. But he leaves open, we're not saying, we're not clearing him, we're not making a determination of any kind, but he really should have. And by not doing it, he is sort of left the door open. That, to me, was all political. Because when Rod Rosenstein and the Office of Legal Counsel and the Attorney General all at once, in about 30 seconds after reading the report, say it does not rise to the level of any type of indictment, then Mueller did all of that. And by the way, all the things he listed were stupid. You agree?
Totally. This is textbook Andrew Weissman smear tactic and throwing red meat to the Democrats to fuel their resistance and impeachment efforts or whatever trouble they want to cause for the next 18 months. That's absolutely all it is. Remember,
let me pick it up right there. Yeah, I want to pick it up there. I mean, if it doesn't rise to the level of an indictable offense, then this information is meaningless. We'll get to that more with Sidney Powell, Peter Schweitzer on the other side. John Solomon at the bottom of the hour. And then Geraldo's, he's wondering if any Democratic candidates are going to apologize to Donald Trump. That'll be fun. Him and Dan Bongino. All coming up Friday edition, Sean Hannity Show. Straight ahead. As we continue, Sidney Powell, author of License to Lie, Peter Schweitzer, author of the book Compromised. Thank you both for being with us. I want to go back, Sidney, to the second part of the Mueller report. He doesn't make a determination, just lays out the facts. Basically, all he's saying is Donald Trump publicly talked about firing Mueller, Rosenstein, Jeff Sessions, and he hoped and was praying that General Flynn didn't get in a lot of trouble. Okay, that's called freedom of speech. He didn't do or act any way on any of these issues, just like the deep state officials that were talking about secretly taping the president or invoking the 25th Amendment. They only talked about it. They didn't do it. So it's not a crime. It's not obstruction. Hillary Clinton's case was obstruction with real intent, with an underlying real crime. So Mueller put it in there. Why?
To throw red meat to the Democrats. It's Mr. Weissman's report. I call it the Weissman report, not the Mueller report. I guarantee you Mr. Mueller didn't write this. I'd be surprised if he even read the whole thing. Maybe he edited a word here and there, but this is textbook Andrew Weissman. It's a smear campaign. It's throwing red meat to the Democrats to fuel the resistance and whatever impeachment and other havoc they want to wreck for the next 18 months to continue the harassment of the president. That's absolutely all it is. There isn't a single case or statute in the obstruction section would warrant an obstruction prosecution. In fact, on page 9, I think it is, they even flag it as potentially relevant obstruction statute. That is a huge red flag right there that they have absolutely
nothing involved. That's a great catch. I actually picked up on that as I was reading it. I actually read through the whole thing, believe it or not. There has to be an underlying crime and there has to be intent. Hillary did violate the Espionage Act. It is irrefutable. The evidence is overwhelming and incontrovertible, and we know that investigation was rigged. We know the intent when she deleted the subpoenaed emails and cleaned up the hard drive with bleach pit and busted up the devices was to destroy evidence in that case. That is, you're a former prosecutor. Is not that a slam dunk obstruction case?
Yes. One of the stunning things about the report is the obstruction of justice legal analysis. If only anything like that had been applied to Hillary Clinton's concrete actions in destroying her BlackBerries, having her hard drive bleach-pitted, completely wiped. Yeah, completely wiped out and destroying all the emails after they'd been subpoenaed. All of that conduct was actual obstruction of justice and destruction of evidence. Nothing they talk about in the report respecting President Trump
just the opposite.
Was obstruction in any way, shape, or form.
Last word, Peter Schweitzer.
Look, all that they're left with after all the claims at the beginning of 2017 that there was massive collusion and cooperation, we're left now with them essentially saying that there were some meetings and there was some contact between Trump campaign officials and Russians. If that is where it's left, the Clinton team has far deeper ties, far closer relationships with those same Russian entities. And I think Sidney talked about it earlier. It's really the double standard that everybody is fed up with. If you want to have a consistent standard, a hard standard, apply it to Trump, apply it to Clinton, that's great, that's fine. I think that's a good thing. But that's not what's happening, and that's why people look at this and believe the process has a lack of credibility.
Exit question, yes or no answer. Will people be indicted, Sidney?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Three yeses. All right, thank you both. Peter Schweitzer, Sidney Powell, we appreciate your insight as always. When we come back, John Solomon, well, he's breaking big news next week. He'll give us a preview. Then Geraldo is asking for Democratic candidates, which one is going to apologize to Donald Trump. Don't hold your breath. He and Dan Bongino will join us. We'll get to your calls as well. 800-941-SEAN on this Friday.